indeed, this worldly life's no more than a pastime and pleasure's vain. The final home, that's life for sure. With their knowledge, this much attain.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وعظيمنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع نفوسنا أبي القاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه الغر الميامين. الحمد لله الذي جعلنا من المتمسكين بولاية سيدي ومولاي علي بن أبي طالب، الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. أما بعد، يقول الله في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: قل لا أسألكم عليه أجرا إلا المودة في القربى. The first of our salawat in honor of Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. The second in honor of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib. The third with your loudest voices in honor of the Imam of our time, Imam Sahib al-Asr wa al-Zaman. Respected scholars, brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. Imam Muhammad bin Ali al-Baqir, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayh. Was born on the 1st of Rajab in the 57th year after Hijrah. And died on the 7th of the Hijjah in the 114th year after Hijrah. He is seen as a colossus of Islamic knowledge and a beacon of light when it comes to each and every one of the Islamic sciences. A man from whose life many lessons may be learnt, especially in the fields of jurisprudence, theology and ethics, and many examples may be derived. And a man who was responsible for the spread and the dissemination of many of the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Unfortunately, Imam al-Baqir's life has not been studied in the way it should be. Many people do not know what his role was amongst the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, and many have not appreciated the amount of knowledge that he disseminated in his life. If you were to ask many people to tell you about the life of Imam al-Baqir, you will find that they are more able to tell you about his son, Imam al-Sadiq, and are not able to elaborate on his own role or on his own transformation of the sciences of the religion of Islam. Yet you find that when you dissect his life, you realize that the solidifying and the crystallization of the school of Ahlul Bayt was performed by Imam al-Baqir. And that's why there is a need to study his life in order that we appreciate that he began a lot of the schools of knowledge that reached us until today. Imam al-Baqir, when we look at his birth, as we said, he was born on the 1st of Rajab in the 57th year after Hijrah. His mother was Fatima, the daughter of Imam al-Hasan. And his father was Imam Zain al-Abidin, the son of Imam al-Husayn. Therefore, from the beginning of his life, he is distinguished with having an honor like nobody else in the school of Ahlul Bayt. that his grandfather from one side is Imam al-Hasan and his grandfather from the other side is Imam al-Hussein. Nobody has this honor in the school of Ahlul Bayt. His mother, Fatima, the daughter of Imam al-Hasan, was one of the most pious and devout wives of any of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt. That the narration say to us that Fatima bint al-Hasan, in terms of her beauty, there was no equivalent to her when it came to her beauty. On the second level, you find that Imam al-Hasan had given his daughter Fatima an apt title. Her title was Siddiqah. That title was, of course, the title of Fatima al-Zahra. And it was a title that continued with Fatima, the daughter of Imam al-Hasan. That on many occasions, Imam al-Baqir would say, my mother Fatima, her title was Siddiqa. She was the truthful. In every aspect of her life, the mother of Imam al-Baqir was known for her truthfulness. Her words, her behavior, her trusts, her religious aspects. There was nobody like her in the whole of Medina who was known for their truthful nature. And that's why you find that her kunya, her title was an interesting one. Her title was Abdullah. Because we find Imam, our fourth Imam, his wife Fatima gave him two sons. She gave him Muhammad al-Baqir and she gave him Abdullah al-Bahir. Abdullah al-Bahir, the brother of Muhammad al-Baqir, was called Abdullah al-Bahir because of his beauty. They used to say of the sons of Zayn al-Abidin, there are no one is as beautiful as Abdullah al-Bahir. Abdullah al-Bahir and Muhammad al-Baqir came from the same mother. Now someone may ask the question, how about Zayd, the son of Imam Zayn al-Abidin? Who did he come from? He came from the wife of Imam Zayn al-Abidin, who was from Sindh. You know Sindh? In the Indo-Pak subcontinent, Sindh. Imam Zayn al-Abidin had married a lady from Sindh who gave him the son Zayd. In other words, of the wives of Imam Zayn al-Abidin, Fatima bint Hassan gave him Muhammad al-Baqir and Abdullah al-Bahir. We find that Imam al-Baqir, as we said, he was born in extremely difficult circumstances. He was born in the 57th year after Hijrah, towards the end of the Khilafah of Muawiyah bin Abi Sufyan. Muawiyah had reached the stage where he had complete dominance on the Islamic Empire. Nobody could come near his dominance. And the narrations say to us that he had killed many of the companions of Amir al-Mu'mineen and many of the companions of Imam al-Hasan as well, as in Muawiyah had killed people like Hujr bin Adi al-Kindi, Rushad al-Hajari. He had killed others, for example, such as Amr bin Hamaq al-Khuza'i. And even further than this, we find with Muawiyah that he had put under pressure many great companions. Maytham al-Tammar, Habib ibn Madahir, Mukhtar al-Thaqafi. Many of these companions were put under immense pressure by Muawiyah. Many people thought Muawiyah, when he dies, he would give the leadership back to Imam al-Hussein. Why? Because Muawiyah had signed a treaty with Imam al-Hassan, and that part of that treaty would be that the leadership would be given back to who? To Ahlul Bayt. However, Muawiyah appointed Yazid to become his successor. And as we know, Muawiyah told Yazid, beware of four. Beware of Abdurrahman ibn Abu Bakr and Abdullah ibn Umar and Abdullah ibn Zubair and Hussein ibn Ali. Beware of these four. Yazid made sure that a couple of them were politically quiet and another one secluded himself. And as we know, Imam al-Hussein rose on the plains of Karbala with his famous lines that a man like me does not pledge allegiance to a man like him. Imam al-Hussein, when he was killed on the 10th of Muharram, Imam al-Baqir was 3.5 years old. And Imam al-Baqir, therefore, was at Karbala at the age of 3.5. Normally, as a child, you want your experiences at that young age to be experiences of warmth, experiences of comfort, experiences of happiness. You don't want to be in an environment at the age of 3.5 where you witness an event like the event of Karbala. But Imam al-Baqir at the age of 3.5 was sitting in the tent with his father Imam Zain al-Abidin at the end of the 10th of Muharram. And you can imagine, for someone 3.5 years of age, he may not necessarily see what's happening outside, but the first thing he sees is his dad very ill on the bed. The second thing he sees is his auntie Zainab running from one tent to another. They burned the tents of Al Muhammad, and when they burned the tents of Al Muhammad, what happened? Aunt Sayyida Zainab would run from one tent to another. Bibi Kulthum would run from one tent to another. Imam al-Baqir as a child had to also run. Why? Because the horses were galloping across the children of Ahlul Bayt. Therefore Imam al-Baqir at the age of 3.5 had to witness Karbala in front of him, and had to also witness the oppression that came after Karbala. Because you know what they did to Imam al-Baqir? He was only 3.5. They chained him next to Ruqayya. Ruqayya bint al-Husayn. And Sukayna bint al-Husayn. And Imam al-Baqir. And the other children of Ahlul Bayt. All of them were chained together and taken from Karbala to Kufa. And from Kufa to Sham. In Sham, Imam al-Baqir said his first words of knowledge in front of Yazid. Because up until that stage, nobody had really asked, who is this young man? His name was Muhammad ibn Ali. They thought he's just like any other Muhammad. At that time, he didn't have any titles. He was only 3.5. Yazid was sitting down on his throne. While Yazid was sitting down on his throne, he looked at Sukayna and Ruqayya, and he looked at Sayyida Zainab and Kulthum, he looked at Rabab, he saw all of them, and when he saw them, he said, you know what, I think the best thing to do with all of you is that some of you will sell you off as slave woman. And the rest of you, you know what we'll do? We're going to kill you one by one. The place became silent. All of a sudden, somebody spoke and said, oh Yazid, when Fir'aun was in power and he caught Musa and Harun, Fir'aun at least asked his people, what should we do to them? And his people said, let them go and live far. Whereas you, Yazid, have no respect for the family of the man who bought this religion. The people looked around. Yazid said, who said that? And they saw a 3-year-old Imam al-Baqir saying that. From that day, Yazid said, how old is this kid? They said, he is 3 years of age. What's his name? They said, Muhammad ibn Ali ibn al-Husayn. He said, which Ali ibn al-Husayn? They said, that one. He said, we killed Ali ibn al-Husayn. He said, no, that's Ali al-Akbar. This is Ali Zain al-Abidin. He said, that 3.5-year-old speaks like that to me? He wanted to do something, but he thought that it would be an act of cowardice if he slapped a 3.5-year-old. So he left them alone, and many of the people realized that this young boy is not an ordinary young boy. Because to be able to answer a Khalifa with knowledge like that is extraordinary. Someone says, what type of knowledge was that? Do you know why it's extraordinary? Not because he's 3 years old, but because how do you have the knowledge of Pharaoh, Moses and Aaron at that age? Who would be able at that moment to say, Fir'aun said to Musa and Harun? Normally you need to learn those stories over a number of years before you have that knowledge. Imam Muhammad ibn Ali at the age of 3.5 was already speaking like this to Yazid. And that's why what happened? Yazid allowed them to be released. They left for Karbala. Then they went to Medina. Imam Muhammad ibn Ali lived under his father Imam Zain al-Abidin for a few years after in Medina. And the narrations tell us that there was a man waiting to give him salams from Rasulullah. Because the young Muhammad ibn Ali, there was a man living in Medina at the time called Jabir bin Abdullah al-Ansari. Jabir bin Abdullah al-Ansari was the oldest surviving companion of Rasulullah. He lived until the age of 90. Some reports say until the age of 93. Jabir's father Abdullah and his grandfather Amr were the most generous and the richest men in Medina. Do you know where their house used to be in Medina? Those of you who've been to Masjid al-Qiblatain, you've been to Masjid al-Qiblatain, where the Qibla got changed. They used to have a mansion next to that house. Not a small house. In those days, most people had small houses. They used to have a mansion. Jabir's father, Abdullah al-Ansari, was known for his generosity to the extent one day he gave away so much money he fell into debt. He would be generous towards everyone. And Jabir's father, Abdullah al-Ansari, was the man who said to the people of Medina, "O people of Medina, I hear that there's a prophet who has announced his prophethood in Mecca. But the people of Mecca do not want him. So let us, the people of Medina, go to him. And let us, the people of Medina, welcome him to our land." And that's why when Rasulullah came to Medina, one of the most hospitable people to Rasulullah was Abdullah al-Ansari, the father of Jabir. And that's why this Abdullah al-Ansari, when it came to the battle of Badr, Abdullah al-Ansari was the man. When it came to the battle of Badr, Jabir came up to him. Jabir, some hadith say, was only 19 at the time. He came up to his father. He said, "Dad, I want to fight today." His dad said, "No." He said to him, "Why?" He said, "You've got 9 older sisters. You have to look after them in case I die." So Jabir went to Rasulullah and he said to him, "Ya Rasulullah, I want to fight with you in the battle of Badr, but my dad isn't allowing me." Rasulullah looked at him and said, "Why?" He said, "Because I have 9 sisters." So he said, "Jabir, you must look after them." So then Jabir said to him, "Ya Rasulullah, so what role can I have in the battle of Badr?" To which Rasulullah replied, "Jabir, carry the water for the soldiers. It is a form of showing love for Allah in this battle." Then in the battle of Uhud, Jabir's father Abdullah got killed. Hind, the mother of Muawiyah, mutilated 2 bodies on the battle of Uhud. Hamza's body and Jabir's father's body. They cut their body into pieces. This Jabir al-Ansari was so close to Ahlul Bayt that Hadith al-Kisa is narrated by Jabir bin Abdullah al-Ansari. Haven't you read Hadith al-Kisa when it says, "An Jabir bin Abdullah al-Ansari, an Fatima Zahra," isn't it? Jabir al-Ansari was so close that he was a companion of Rasulullah. He was a companion of Imam Ali. He was a companion of Imam al-Hassan. He was a companion of Imam al-Hussein. He was a companion of Imam Zain al-Abidin. And Rasulullah said to him, "Oh Jabir, one day you will meet a young man whose name is my name, whose attributes are like my attributes, who has nur shining from his face, and who has wisdom and knowledge like none other. His name is Al-Baqir. Make sure you send my salams to him." Jabir would be sitting outside the mosque of the Prophet saying, "Where is Al-Baqir? Where is Al-Baqir?" And the people would walk past and say, "Jabir's old age has got to him. Jabir is becoming insane. Jabir is just saying loud words." All of a sudden one day, you find that the narrations say Imam Zain al-Abidin brought Muhammad ibn Ali and he said, "Oh Jabir, there is someone who wants to see you." Jabir was blind at the end of his life. Jabir looked at him and he touched him and he said, "I felt the footsteps of Rasulullah coming towards me." Because you know, when someone is blind, their other senses become stronger. Their other senses become sharper. Jabir said, "I feel the footsteps of Rasulullah." "Who is this?" Imam Zain al-Abidin said, "This is Muhammad ibn Ali, the one you are calling Al-Baqir." Jabir took Imam al-Baqir, he placed him in his lap and he said, "I want to kiss your hands, I want to kiss your feet. Your grandfather Rasulullah said to me, oh Jabir, send my salams." When Rasulullah says, "Send my salams to someone," do you know how knowledgeable this person must be for Rasulullah to send his salams to him? He said, "Send my salams to Muhammad al-Baqir and know that he is al-Baqir because he will split knowledge completely." People ask the word Baqir, what does it mean? Of course, it's not his name, it's his title. Baqir comes from the word Baqir. Baqir, what does it mean? When a farmer rips his farmland or rips open the soil, they call it Baqir. Imam al-Baqir, because he ripped and split and scrutinized and spread knowledge, they called him al-Baqir. Or they would call him Baqir al-Ulum, the one who splits. Please mark the three S's. He splits knowledge, scrutinizes knowledge, spreads knowledge. That is a lesson for us today. That we who claim to follow Imam al-Baqir, have we split knowledge open? Have we scrutinized knowledge? Have we spread our knowledge? You see, some people made fun of Imam al-Baqir because they were jealous of him. Do you know, one person was walking one day, he looked at Imam al-Baqir, he said, Baqir! Baqir is different from Baqir. What does Baqir mean? Surah al-Baqarah. Surah al-Baqarah means what in English? The cow. Someone came to Imam al-Baqir one day when he heard Jabir bin Abdullah Ansar say to him, Baqir! Imagine in the face of Imam al-Baqir, you call him the cow. And Imam al-Baqir looked at the person and said to him, no, my title is al-Baqir. And the person said to him, your mother, her job is a cook, nothing more. He said, that is her profession. Then he said, I heard your mother was a black woman. Shame on you. Imam said, if you are telling the truth, may Allah forgive you. And if you are lying, may Allah forgive you as well. People would hear this name Al-Baqir. Some would try and make fun of him and call him Baqir or Baqara, the cow. Whereas Imam Al-Baqir would reply to them with akhlaq. He would be patient until there'd be a day when he'd disseminate his knowledge. And that's why the narrations say to us that the reason he was given the name Baqir was because in a period where many different schools of knowledge were emerging, people went to him when they needed to split and scrutinize and understand knowledge. Imam al-Baqir, in his time as an imam, he faced over five khulafa of Bani Abbas. Of Bani Umayyah, sorry. Five khulafa. You had in his time some of these khulafa, I tell you. Some of them were the most unreligious caliphs you'll ever find. And in some cases, because they were so unreligious, it actually helped him spread his message. Because they were more concerned with the world of woman, and the world of music, and the world of luxury. Imam al-Baqir thought, wow, these people are busy, let me spread the knowledge of Al Muhammad. You found in his time, you had different types of caliphs. Abdul Malik ibn Marwan was a caliph in the time of Imam al-Baqir. Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, how was he as a caliph? He employed Hajjaj bin Yusuf al-Thaqafi as his governor. Hajjaj bin Yusuf al-Thaqafi used to say, I wish I was present on the 10th of Muharram, so I could have been the man who beheaded the grandson of Rasulullah. You put someone like this as your governor? And the books of history say Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, the great Khalifa of Islam. Which Khalifa? This is the Khalifa you want? Someone who puts a man like this in power? Abdul Malik ibn Marwan employs Hajjaj. Hajjaj comes on Eid al-Adha. Those of you who have been to Hajj, what do we do on Eid al-Adha? We sacrifice, don't we? We sacrifice animals. Hajjaj used to say, what do the people do on Eid al-Adha? The reply was, people sacrifice animals. Hajjaj said, very well, get me everyone called Ali, Hassan and Hussein so I can sacrifice them as well. Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, Imam al-Baqir would see someone like this. Imam al-Baqir had to face Sulaiman bin Abdul Malik. You think the dad was bad? Look at Sulaiman. Sulaiman bin Abdul Malik, when he became Khalifa, they used to say to him, please lead Salat al-Jum'ah. You are the Khalifa of the Muslims. People expect you to lead Salah. He used to look at them and he says, are you joking? I've got two women in my room right now. And you want me to come out and pray? Get someone else to lead this Salat al-Jum'ah. Get someone else who can lead. And this Sulaiman bin Abdul Malik used to have two girls who would be around him all the time. One was called Salama and the other was called Hababa. This is the type of people Imam al-Baqir had to live under. One was called Salama, the other was called Hababa. Sulaiman bin Abdul Malik used to keep Hababa next to him. At the time of Salat al-Jum'ah, he used to sing his poetry. He used to say, while all of these people are going down in their prayers, I'm enjoying the comforts of life with Salama and Hababa. One day Allah taught him a lesson and taught both of them a lesson, these two. Do you know how they both died? Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan died because of a disease where if he drank water, he dies. Imagine, if you drink water, you die. And Sulaiman bin Abd al-Malik, while in Salat al-Jum'ah, they were praying and he's sitting with his friend. Sulaiman bin Abd al-Malik, he brings some of the pomegranates. He's like to her, eat more, enjoy. She's eating the pomegranates, he's eating, she's eating. One pomegranate seed chokes in her throat. It stops there. It chokes her and she dies. Imagine, Sulaiman bin Abd al-Malik has the whole empire under his hand, a pomegranate seed ends up killing him. And when he sees this, he falls on top of her, doesn't leave the house, he ends up dying in this way. Imam al-Baqir knew there were khulafa like this. So what did Imam al-Baqir do? Did he stand up? No. Imam al-Baqir thought, if these people are engaged in these things, let me sit down and spread the message of Ahlul Bayt and their teachings. Because the climate Imam al-Baqir was living in, many new schools of Islam were developing. Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, Imam al-Hassan, Imam al-Hussein, Imam Zain al-Abidin were not able in their own respective times to spread the teachings of Rasulullah because they were under much pressure. Imam al-Baqir is the man who began the spread of the teachings of Rasulullah in the school of Ahlul Bayt. He used to sit in the mosque of Rasulullah and he used to spread the words of Rasulullah to everybody. Because people heard Jabir say, this man is Al-Baqir. He splits, he scrutinizes, he spreads knowledge. You found many people would come and ask Imam Al-Baqir questions. And that's why, do you know what the narrations say to us? There were different schools in Islam which were forming. Lots of people started claiming they heard this from Rasulullah, they heard that from Rasulullah. And you had many schools emerging. There was a school called the Murji'ah in the time of Imam Al-Baqir. Do you know what the Murji'ah used to say? You can't say a Khalifa is bad because he's drinking alcohol. Because you don't know what's his heart, what's in his heart. What do you mean I don't know what's in his heart? I see him drinking alcohol. What else do I need to know? The man sitting there drinking alcohol, he's drunk completely and you're telling me I don't know what's in his heart? There was another school which was the Khawarij. You know those who fought Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen at Nahrawan? They were also present at the time. There was another school called the Mu'tazila, who had debates about predestination and free will and the position of the Muslim sinner in the Islamic State. In other words, what you had in that period of Islam, many people were confused, I tell you. Many were confused. They didn't know who to follow. You've got this school and that school and that school and this school. So people all decided to go and study under Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. And that university in Medina. That's why they say about Imam al-Sadiq and Imam al-Baqir, they call them al-Baqirain. Sometimes people call them al-Sadiqain. No, it's al-Baqirain. Imam al-Sadiq says, the greatest teacher I had in my life was my father Muhammad al-Baqir. And on top of this, you know what Imam al-Sadiq used to say? I didn't just learn Islamic studies from my father. We studied astronomy, we studied cosmology, we studied geography, we studied philosophy, we studied Greek mysticism and thought. Imagine! Imam al-Baqir did not just teach Islamic law, Islamic theology, Islamic ethics. Imam al-Baqir wanted to show Muslims every science is worthy of learning in the religion of Islam. You don't just have to learn fiqh or hadith or Quran. Go and learn every science and be learned on every area. Imam al-Baqir, people would come to him. If they had a Quran question, they would ask him. If they had a legal question, they would ask him. If they had a history question, they would ask him. If they had a question about hadith, they would ask him. If they had a question about imama, they would ask him. Look at some examples. A person came to him and said, oh Imam, there is a verse in the Quran. We have asked so many scholars, they don't know the answer to it. Can you give us the answer? You are Muhammad al-Baqir. You are the one whose title is that you split knowledge in half. He said, go ahead. He said, chapter 21, verse 30. Have those disbelievers not seen how the heavens and the earth were closed and we opened them up? In Arabic, they were ratq and they became fatq. Surah 21 verse 30. What does this mean, Imam al-Baqir? That the heavens and the earth were closed and we opened them. Imam al-Baqir replied, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Adam on the earth, there was no vegetation because there was no rain. So Allah opened up the heavens so rain would come down and the fertile land would have plants growing from it. They would say thank you. Another group would come. Mu'ammar al-Layfi, a famous scholar of the time, comes to Imam al-Baqir. He says to him, oh Muhammad al-Baqir, we have a question about Islamic law. He said, go ahead, tell me, what's your question? He said, do you, the Imamis, believe in mut'ah, the temporary marriage? He said, yes, we do. He says, but don't you think mut'ah is a type of zina? To which Imam al-Baqir replied, Rasulullah would not sanction a type of zina. Because the Quran in chapter 4 verse 24 clearly says, فَمَسْتَمْتَعْتُمْ بِهِ مِنْهُنَّ فَآتُوهُنَّ أُجُورَهُنَّ فَرِيضًا. The Quran says very clearly, Surah 4 verse 24 is the verse which proves mut'ah, that in the time of Rasulullah there were companions like Jabir bin Abdullah al-Ansari and others, when they would go away from their homes and they would want to look after themselves in terms of their desires, they would say, Ya Rasulullah, are we allowed to engage in a temporary marriage? To which Rasulullah would say, yes. So do you know what Mu'ammar al-Layth turned around to Imam al-Baqir and said? Would you allow your woman to do it? Such questions aren't befitting of a scholar. Today even you find people, when they debate the issue of mut'ah, they will come forward and say, would you allow your sister to do it? Imam al-Baqir, first and foremost, the law of mut'ah is that if your woman are virgins, then you have to seek the permission of the father. There is a jurisprudence to it. You don't just allow mut'ah for anyone. There is a law behind it. Then Imam al-Baqir, number two, what did he say? He said to him, oh Mu'ammar, if a person who does knitting from Medina came and proposed for your daughter, would you allow your daughter to get married? Mu'ammar said, no, I wouldn't give her to someone who knits. He said, but isn't it halal? So he said, yes. He said, therefore, if it's halal, you don't necessarily have to do it. Likewise with us, mut'ah is halal does not mean mut'ah is wajib. It's difference. Because mut'ah is halal does not mean everyone practices it. You come and tell me, would your sister do it? It's as if you're implying that it's wajib on my sister to do it. No, it's optional. Mu'ammar left with his head down and walked away. Then a third group of people would come to Imam al-Baqir. They would be the history group. They would come and say, oh Muhammad ibn Ali, we have a question none can answer. Says, what is it? Says, our question is, who was the first person to ever speak the Arabic language? And Imam al-Baqir would look at them and say, the first person to speak the Arabic language was Prophet Ismail alayhi salam. At the age of 10, because Prophet Ismail, where was he brought up? Where was Prophet Ismail brought up? Mecca. Prophet Ismail, where was he born? He was born or he was raised in that area. So he says the first Prophet to speak Arabic was Prophet Ismail. Then another group of people come to Imam al-Baqir. They say, oh Imam, you know Shaytan is the enemy of all the Prophets? The Imam says yes. So they said to him, did Shaytan ever have conversations with any of the Prophets? Imam would look at them and say yes. So they said to him, who? He would say, Shaytan had a conversation with Prophet Nuh alayhi salam. So they would turn around to him and they say, so what was the conversation between the two of them? So Imam al-Baqir would say, Shaytan would come to Prophet Nuh and say to him, oh Prophet Nuh, I am going to give you a present because you done me a great favor. So Prophet Nuh looked at Shaytan and said, what do you mean? He said, because you prayed to Allah to remove all those who had oppressed the religion, so Allah removed them, so I didn't have any work in your generation. So then Prophet Nuh said, so what's the present you're going to give me? So Shaytan looked at Prophet Nuh and said, I'm going to give you three pieces of advice. He said, what? He said, remember me in three places. I'm always there. So then Prophet Nuh said, where? He said, when number one, when you are angry, know that I'm always standing next to you looking to make you more angry. How many times when you get angry do you feel there's a whisper saying, go ahead and hit him. Go ahead. الَّذِي يُوَسْوِسْ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ. Number two, when you're about to give charity, know that I'm always whispering, don't give, don't give. Number three, when you are alone with the opposite gender, know that I am the third of the three. You two are alone, I will be there whispering. Imam al-Baqir would give that. Then another question people would come. Imagine this school in Medina, Imam al-Baqir had thousands of students under him. Another person would come to Imam al-Baqir and say, you imams claim you are ma'soom, you are infallible. He said, yes. So what's the proofs for it? So Imam al-Baqir said, why do human beings sin? So the person looked at him and said, I don't know, you tell me. He said, because of four reasons. Either because of anger, or because of lust, or because of envy, or because of greed. Why would we need to be greedy when Allah has given us the knowledge that He's given us? And why would we be envious when we are the grandchildren of Rasulullah? And why would we lust over anything when Allah has honored us with the Holy Quran? And why would we get angry over anything when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed the message of prophethood to be in our lines? Therefore, a person normally commits a sin because of lust or anger or envy, or because of what? Or because of desire? Allah has given us so much that those four never affect us in our life. Therefore, what do you find? Imam al-Baqir, he would disseminate knowledge, and many of his students emerged from his school. People like Zurara and Hamran and people of that caliber, Jabir bin Yazid al-Ju'fi, would emerge, who would continue to spread his words everywhere. But do you think that the Khulafa were affected? One Khalifa was affected in a good way, another was affected in the bad way. Do you know which Umayyad Khalifa was affected by Imam al-Baqir? Umar bin Abdul Aziz. Umar bin Abdul Aziz's father-in-law is Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. Umar bin Abdul Aziz is the great-grandson of Umar ibn al-Khattab. Up until the time of Imam al-Baqir, every Salatul Jum'ah khutbah had to begin, in the name of God, the most beneficent, the most merciful, may God curse Ali ibn Abi Talib. That's why I believe it's a myth, this idea that Ali ibn Abi Talib was the forthrightly guided Khalifa in that time. That's impossible. That came later. How could he be the forthrightly guided Khalifa and Bani Umayyah were in charge for 80 years? Every week on a Friday prayer, Ali ibn Abi Talib was cursed. Umar bin Abdul Aziz, because of Imam al-Baqir's knowledge, and because of the knowledge of the people of the time, Umar bin Abdul Aziz was Khalifa of Bani Umayyah. But when he saw the knowledge of Imam al-Baqir, and even Umar bin Abdul Aziz says, my father Abdul Aziz, whenever he talk about Ali ibn Abi Talib, he used to get nervous. So I used to say to my father, whenever you talk about any man, you are calm except Ali ibn Abi Talib. Why? To which my father would say to me, if the people knew the merits of Ali ibn Abi Talib, they would not have us as leaders. But Umar bin Abdul Aziz got affected by Imam al-Baqir and by a personal tutor. Umar bin Abdul Aziz was the man, a Bani Umayyah Khalifa, he stopped the cursing of Imam Ali on the minbar. Then this Umar bin Abdul Aziz, one day when he became Khalifa, said to Imam al-Baqir, O Muhammad ibn Ali, you are the one who Rasulullah sent his salams to. I want to ask you a question. What three pieces of advice do you give me now that I've become Khalifa? Umar bin Abdul Aziz could have gone to anyone else. But Baqir al-Ulum, the man who splits knowledge, is there anyone better to learn about Rasulullah than him? Umar bin Abdul Aziz asked him, Imam al-Baqir gave him three pieces of fantastic advice. The first advice, he said to him, when you celebrate or have an extravagant celebration, do not forget halal and haram. You may go to a lot of weddings in the summer. A lot of weddings. And they are called Islamic weddings. The nikah is in the mosque. That's where people like me get invited. But the not so religious event, I never get invited to for some reason. No one ever sends me a card. I don't know why. Maybe because I am someone who, I don't know. Imam al-Baqir told Umar bin Abdul Aziz, when you celebrate an occasion, don't forget halal and haram. In our communities today, our nikah is religious. Go to the reception and only God knows what's going on. And you see some people in those receptions, you look at them and you're like, you're a follower of Muhammad al-Baqir? You? And then you ask them, why have you made it like this? They say, because the community will say it's boring otherwise. On the day of judgment, will the community say it's boring? Number one, when you celebrate, don't forget halal and haram. That's very important. Number two, when you become angry, don't forget halal and haram. Sometimes we get angry, but it's haram to curse. Sometimes we get angry, we may even curse Allah. Imam said, when you get angry, don't forget halal haram. I'm not saying don't get angry, but do not forget halal haram. Then he said, oh Umar bin Abdul Aziz, number three, when you get, do not usurp the property of the people. So they had a conversation. He said, which property, for example? He said, Fadak belonged to my grandmother Fatima. And Bani Umayyah took Fadak away from my grandmother. Umar bin Abdul Aziz said, Fadak belongs to your family and I as Khalifa will make sure it's given back to you. Umar bin Abdul Aziz, although we may differ from him on certain aspects, but his two stands because of Imam al-Baqir of returning Fadak and stopping the cursing of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen will never be forgotten. That's one person. But then you had the Khalifa after Umar bin Abdul Aziz, or in the time of Umar bin Abdul Aziz, Hisham bin Abdul Malik, who absolutely despised Imam al-Baqir. He was envious of him. How could this person have more knowledge than me and I am Khalifa? He tried every way possible to embarrass Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. Every way. Do you know, I tell you, for about 5 years, this Hisham bin Abdul Malik, for a few years, Hisham bin Abdul Malik, you know what he would do? He'd get the most knowledgeable Christians, the most knowledgeable atheists, the most knowledgeable Muslims from outside the school of Ahlul Bayt to debate Imam al-Baqir. One day, Hisham bin Abdul Malik is sitting near the Kaaba. He had with him Nafi'. Nafi' used to be the slave of Umar ibn al-Khattab, and he was of the Khawarij who fought Imam Ali. They saw Imam al-Baqir walk towards the Kaaba, and everyone opened up the space. Nafi' said, who's that? Hisham bin Abdul Malik said, he's the prophet of the people of Iraq. Nafi' said, what do you mean? He said, they call him al-Baqir. Apparently he can split knowledge and answer questions no one can answer. Nafi' said, leave this guy to me. Bring him. Let me show him. Nafi' calls him. He says, Baqir, come here. Come. Imam al-Baqir comes. He says, I hear the people say you're knowledgeable. Imam al-Baqir says, I am not of the ignorant. What a line. I am not of the ignorant. Don't say I'm an alim. Today everybody likes to be called alim, yes? The amount of titles we've created, it's unbelievable. So, I'm not of the ignorant. So Nafi' said, very well, answer my questions if you think you have any knowledge. Imam al-Baqir said, go ahead. Nafi' said, what was the number of years between Jesus and Muhammad? Imam al-Baqir looked at him and he said, in your opinion, 600. In my opinion, 500. How do you know it's his opinion, Imam al-Baqir? You know when an Imam takes the level of knowledge up? He's like to him, in your opinion, 600. In mine, 500. Nafi' staring at him, thinking, how does this guy know my opinion on this issue? Then he says to him, Muhammad, in Surah 43, verse 45, God says, O Muhammad, or O Prophet of God, ask the prophets who came before you, did they tell the people to disbelieve in other than God? At this moment he said to Muhammad, how could Allah tell the Prophet to ask those who came before him? That's impossible. The Prophets who came before him have gone. Imam al-Baqir said, no, on the night of Mi'raj, Allah let his prophet lead all the prophets in namaz. And when he finished his salah, he turned around and he said to them, did you ever tell your people to disbelieve in Allah? And they said, no, O Prophet of God, we told them to believe in Allah and in your prophethood. Nafa said, you're good. Where's God? Imam al-Baqir said, where's God? Your Baqir al-Ulum, where's God? Imam al-Baqir looked at him and said, show me where he is not, I'll show you where he is. What an answer. Then he said to him, okay, when did God come about? Imam said, show me when he was not, I'll show you when he came. Nafi was now shaking. And Imam al-Baqir done something which is called finish him. You know finish him? Imam al-Baqir looked at him and said, Nafi, I hear you're from the Khawarij. He said, yes. He said, let me ask you a question. Do you agree with the Khawarij who fought Ali ibn Abi Talib at Nahrawan? Because I'm going to give you two answers, and they're the only answers you can give me. If you agree, then you're a disbeliever, because fighting the Khalifa of your time is kufr. And if you disagree, then you're a disbeliever, because you were one of them who fought. So you're a disbeliever as well. What of the two are you now? Nafi' ran away, said, I'm never debating this man again. That was one occasion. Abdul Malik went crazy, said, how did this happen? Hisham went crazy. He said, how could none of you answer? So Hisham went ahead with someone else. He said, come, I beg you, you're the top scholar, debate Muhammad al-Baqir, finish him. This man's getting too popular. People say he is al-Baqir, he splits all knowledge, no one can answer him. So this scholar said, leave him to me, I'll ask him. So he came to him, he said to him, I've got some questions for you. You claim to be al-Baqir, answer my questions. He said, go ahead. He said, but you know my questions are from Bible and Quran. He said, go ahead. He said, my first question is this, and it's an important question. Which fast in history were you allowed to eat and drink? Number two, firstly I asked him this question. He said, which fast in history were you allowed to eat and drink? Imam al-Baqir said, it's simple, the fast of Bibi Maryam, when Allah told her to remain silent, that was her fasting. So then he said to him, I have a second question. Tell me, when was a quarter of humanity killed? In which occasion? Imam al-Baqir said, simple, when Qabil killed Habil, a quarter of humanity died. Number three, what increases and never decreases? Imam al-Baqir said, the water of the ocean. He said to him, what decreases and never increases? He says, your age. Then he said to him, which statement was true, but Allah said it was a lie? Imam al-Baqir said, the first verse in Surah Al-Munafiqun. The Munafiqun come to you and say, you are the Prophet of God, but we know that they are liars. The statement is true. The testimony is true, but the statement is a lie. Then he said to him, I'll ask you a question none can ever answer me. Imam al-Baqir said, what? He said, which twins were born on the same day, died on the same day, but one of them was 150, the other was 50. You need to be Baqir to answer this question, true? You need to be able to split knowledge in half. He said to him, it's easy. Prophet Uzair and his brother Aziz. Prophet Uzair and his brother were together. Then he asked Allah, how do you raise the dead and make them alive? Allah caused them to die for 100 years, isn't it? So they were both 30, but Allah caused one of them to die for 100 years. When Prophet Uzair came back alive because of Allah's permission, he lived for 20 years. That means the elder brother was 150 and he was 50 years of age. He said, I swear there is no inheritor of knowledge of Rasulullah like Muhammad al-Baqir. Then there was a third person who was a Christian. Hisham bin Abdul Malik bought him. He was a Christian. Hisham bin Abdul Malik said to him, finish Muhammad al-Baqir off. The Christian said, I've got three questions to ask this man. First, are you from the line of Jesus or Muhammad? He said, I'm from the line of Muhammad. He said, are you of the scholars or of the ignorant? He said, I'm not of the ignorant. He said, let me ask you my three questions. He said, go ahead. He said to him, which period is neither day or night? He said, just before sunrise, the color of the sky is neither day or night. He said, what happens in that period to the human being? He said, if you're ill, Allah removes your illness at that period of the night. He said to him, okay, you say in heaven that we will eat so much, but we won't excrete. How can that be? He said, the embryo in the womb, it eats and eats and eats, but doesn't excrete. He said, okay, you say in heaven that we'll eat and eat and eat, but there'll still be so much food. How can that be? He said, the candle which lights another candle, but doesn't lose any of its source. It's like the food in Jannah. That person became a Muslim at that moment because of Imam al-Baqir. Every angle of knowledge, Imam al-Baqir has covered. But there's an important question. Imam al-Baqir, did he only serve Islam through his knowledge? No. Imam al-Baqir also had a job. Many scholars of Islam today, all they do is teach the religion, which is fantastic. But Imam al-Baqir taught us, like my grandfather Amir al-Mu'mineen, teach Islam, give lectures, teach Quran, but also go out and earn a living. Muhammad ibn Munkar says it was the heat of Medina. I'm walking, there's no one in the streets. I see one man in the field plowing and plowing and plowing. I said, who is this man who is chasing the world at this time? I get nearer, I see it's the grandson of Rasulullah, Muhammad al-Baqir. When I come to him, I say, oh grandson of Rasulullah, you are chasing the dunya, you are chasing the world, what are you doing working in this heat? He said to me, and what is wrong with me working? If I die in this state, at least I am dying in a state of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For earning a living is a form of worshipping Allah. And Allah does not like to see hands except the hands of a person who earns a living in halal in their life on the day of judgment. Therefore Imam al-Baqir used to work. Imam al-Baqir earns a living because he had five sons and two daughters from his wife Umm Farwa, the daughter of Qasim, the son of Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, and from his other wife Al-Thaqafiyya. He had to earn a living for his seven children. And that's why you find that those Umayyad Khulafa could not take it anymore. Imam al-Baqir, before he died, in one area of Imam al-Baqir you must read is when he talks about what is the meaning of a follower of Imam al-Baqir. There are many lectures of Imam al-Baqir about him talking about what are his Shia, what is the meaning of following him. In one hadith he says, our followers are three types. One of them are those who follow us but rely and depend on others. The second are like glass, all they do is watch themselves as a reflection and nothing else. The third of our Shia, our followers, are like gold. The more they suffer, the more they shine. In another hadith, Imam al-Baqir says, our followers, when Allah loves His servant, He drowns him in the sea of suffering. Sometimes we have Shia followers, Muslim followers in the world today who say, why is Allah making me suffer? Why is Allah making me in trouble? Imam al-Baqir says, our followers are like gold. The more they suffer, the more they shine. They look at Allah's tests and they say, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. And that's why when the Umayyad Khulafa became jealous of Imam al-Baqir, they began to spread the poison into the food of Imam al-Baqir. And some even began to put a needle in his saddle, so if he sat on the saddle, the needle would go through the thigh of Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. And Imam al-Baqir, before he died, his wasiyah is a beautiful wasiyah. The first thing he said to Imam al-Sadiq, spend the money that I've left behind to spread ilm. Because education is the essence of the school of Islam. Number two, bury me with my robe which I used to pray my salah with. Because salah will speak for me on the day of judgment. Number three, make sure you organize majalis at Mina every year in Hajj. The majalis not of just Imam al-Baqir, but the majalis of my grandfather Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. Make sure you organize majalis. Imam al-Baqir, 100 of his students graduated in reading Nawha and Qasida and Maktam about Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. And that's why Imam al-Baqir has the famous hadith that whoever cries a tear the size of a wing of a fly for Imam al-Hussein, that tear can cure sins the size of the ocean. Therefore, you found Imam al-Baqir in his life, all areas of knowledge, theology, ethics, jurisprudence, astronomy, cosmology, physics, biology, all of them he taught, and especially as an icing on the cake, and the most important knowledge was the knowledge of the majlis of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. And therefore you find tomorrow we will study the man who looked after the knowledge of Imam al-Baqir, Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us the ziyarah of Imam al-Baqir in Jannat al-Baqi'. Allow us to be amongst those who honor his knowledge and spread his knowledge in the way he spread his knowledge in his lifetime as well in our lifetime. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the Surah al-Fatiha, but before it the loudest of your salawat.